I want to welcome everybody to the James Madison Institute's 2015 Annual Dinner. I'm Bob McClure, President and CEO of the James Madison Institute. It's an honor to have you all here. It's going to be a terrific, terrific evening. I know many of you have traveled from the far corners of the state and have taken time out of your busy schedule to join us tonight, and we're grateful that you've done that. It was Thomas Jefferson who said in his first inaugural address, "A wise and frugal government which shall restrain men from injuring one another shall leave them otherwise free to regulate their own pursuits of industry and improvement, and shall not take from the mouth of labor the bread it has earned." This, he finished, is the sum of good government. The free enterprise system has done more to lift people out of poverty, far more than any government, any poverty program possible. Precisely because, as Abraham Lincoln said, when one starts poor, as most do in the race in life, free society is such that he knows he can better his condition. He knows there is no fixed condition of labor for one's life. Or as Milton Friedman, the great economist, put more succinctly, nations that value equality over freedom get neither equality nor freedom. But those nations that value freedom over equality get the highest degree of both. JMI is Florida's oldest and largest free market think tank, promoting the principles of limited government and personal responsibility and economic freedom for all. Because we believe a rising tide lifts all boats, regardless of race, creed, age, or religion. And history has borne this out. Throughout the night, you'll hear a lot about JMI, and we hope you'll walk away knowing we're not just a think tank, but a do tank. We do four things here at the Institute. We empower Floridians through education about what makes nations and states the most free and allows those states and those nations to be more prosperous, more generous, and more charitable. We equip individual citizens like yourselves and those across the state and really across the country with the tools to carry forth the torch of freedom to their own children and grandchildren, their churches and synagogues, and the hundreds of thousands of associations that Americans are a part of. Number three, we educate policymakers at all levels and work with them to establish the best policy decisions for all Floridians. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, we engage the culture, especially the next generation. From movies to music to technology, all of those things, because we believe there is a universal hunger for freedom, regardless of political party or preference. But we couldn't do what we do without the support of you all in this room and those who weren't able to be with us here tonight. We're not a lobbying firm. We're not a contract research firm. We're simply supported by thousands of people across the state and across the country who believe in our mission. And you have some of that in your program tonight, which you'll hear more about in just a little bit. And we couldn't put together such a great night with the help of many, and I'd like to thank some of them now. First, our generous sponsors who believe in our mission and have given their time to help make this evening possible, and specifically our dinner sponsor, Michael Durden from the Durden Foundation, as well as our VIP reception sponsors, Glenn and Sandra Blau, the Rob Goodell Family Foundation, Charlene and Senator Pat Neal, Jeff and Mary Swain, Elite Store Business, and Kalitas Business. Please join me in giving all of our sponsors a round of applause. I'd also like to thank our current JMI board members. Many of them are here tonight. Some of them are not, but you need to know who they are. They're terrific folks. I heard a great general who was over in the Middle East say, you know, there are three rules to great leadership. He said, the first is to surround yourself with the best people, and I really can't remember rules two and three. And I'm fortunate enough to have a terrific board of directors along with a terrific staff. If you'd hold your applause, I do want to recognize them, though. Chairman and former Speaker of the Florida House, Alan Bentz from Panama City. Many of you remember the great Charles Hilton from Panama City as well. He was Chairman Emeritus. He hired me almost 10 and a half years ago. Couldn't be with us here tonight. Vice Chairman from Orlando, Rob Goodell. From Tallahassee, Secretary Jeff Swain. It's right here. From Naples, our Treasurer Glenn Blau. From Pensacola, Stan Conley. And then we have several who couldn't join us tonight. J.F. Bryan from Jacksonville, George Gibbs from Jacksonville, John Rabusha from Lakeland, John Kirtley from Tampa, Fred Linhart from Orlando, and Tom Sittema from Orlando as well. You'll be hearing from many of these folks that I've just introduced to you in just a few minutes. I'd also like to acknowledge several of our past JMI board members who are with us tonight. Senator Pat Neal, former JMI board member. Tom Silty. There he is. Tom Silty from Pensacola. Ed Moore. Is Ed here as well? Okay. Right. Great. And then Frank Shaw Jr. I don't know if Frank Shaw Jr. was able to join us tonight. I don't see him here. Okay. And then finally, I'd like to thank my staff who organized the event and did a terrific job putting this together and worked so hard to bring it all to the fore. Would all of our staff with the James Madison Institute please stand? I've got an amazing team that I'm honored to be a part of. Please join me in thanking them. I'd also like to recognize the elected officials in the room who took the time to be here tonight. As many of you may know, it's legislative session. And so it's a busy time here in Tallahassee, and we're grateful that they have been able to join us tonight. You're going to hear from some of them in just a few minutes. I'd like to thank the Chief Financial Officer of the state of Florida, Jeff Atwater, for joining us. I want to thank the Commissioner of Agriculture, Adam Putnam, for being here tonight. The Speaker of the House, Steve Crisafulli, was here during the reception but had to get back to work, but I wanted to thank him for being here as well. Representative Larry Metz is also here. Representative Keith Perry is here. Representative Dan Rollerson, here. Former Representative Don Brown, is Don here? See him? And then I've already introduced former Senator and former House member, Pat Neal, who's with us here tonight as well. Former Representative Sherry McInvale is here. And then from the Senate, we have current Senator Garrett Richter. Thank you for being here as well. The theme for tonight is the Florida story, a lasting legacy. And really what a story we have in this state. Many of you in this room have your own Florida story, whether you were born and raised here, have generations going back for years, or have moved here at some point in your life. We all have a unique story to tell about the Sunshine State. As a fifth-generation Floridian, born and raised in North Florida, I was fortunate to have a great-grandfather who was in the Florida Senate as a former Senate president and later served on the Supreme Court, and then an uncle who served as a Florida Senate president in 1955, so 1915 and 1955. It's a terrific state, and we've seen so much happen over the last 30 or 40 years. Tonight, we're here to feature the stories of a few select folks as we celebrate our state and how far we've come. I think Florida's story is one of economic success, but more than that, it can also serve as a model for the entire country. If you think about Florida, demographically, the entire country is right here in one state. And so what happens in a state like Florida, the entire country begins to watch and take notice. And I think that's important for all of us to understand. I've heard many say, if the weather was the sole reason that people were moving to Florida, then why are taxpayers fleeing California? We would argue that California is the bellwether for everything that's wrong with public policy in the country. As my favorite economist, you've probably learned by now, Milton Friedman said, if government were in charge of the Sahara Desert, there'd be a shortage of sand within 5 years. We've got a lot of speakers to come, but I want to draw your attention to the note cards on the table. We would like attendees to submit questions for me to ask Steve Hayes, who will be more formally introduced in just a few minutes, during that portion of the evening. There are two ways you can do that. You can use the note cards to write a question, so please include your first name and your city, as we want to recognize you for that. You can also submit a question via Twitter. You can tweet us at the James Madison Institute's handle. And we'll say your handle for the question. So either way, we'd love for you to do that. And we'll read through these questions and pull them together. And we're going to have a terrific night with Steve. Please be sure to submit via Twitter or write down your questions. And we'll come and get them while you all are eating dinner. Now I'd like to invite Derek McGee to come forward. As he's making his way forward, Derek is a member of JMI's Leaders Fellowship Program. He's going to lead us in the invocation. Last year, JMI started a dynamic program for young professionals called the Leaders Fellowship Program, and they're interested in our mission. As one of the members of the young leaders said, you know, being a part of this program, I learned two things. One, I'm not alone, and two, I'm not crazy. And I think it's important that we remember that tonight. We have chapters in Miami, Tampa, Orlando, and Tallahassee, and program participants are selected through a rigorous nomination process and includes some of the most impressive young professionals from really around the state. We have nearly 100 folks in our Leaders Fellowship Program in this inaugural group, and they have accomplished great things here in Florida. A handful were able to take the time out of their busy schedules to be with us tonight. Some came from different areas of the state. And I'd like to ask those leader fellows to please stand. Thank you all for being here. If you're under 40, and I'm not, and you're interested in being a part of that program, grab one of our staffers, and they'll be able to share with you more about it. Derek?
Good evening, everyone. If we can bow our heads just for a moment. God, in times like these, we're appreciative to live in the freest country, that we can come together and be able to fellowship together. So tonight, as we converse in fellowship, we're just humble for the many blessings we experience. We thank you for your blessings. Thank you that we're mindful of how blessed we are. And we just pray and we just ask that we will continue to live our lives with a heart of thanksgiving, with the thoughts of peace, knowing that there is someone somewhere who does not have the privileges that we have. But we thank you tonight that you continue to shower down upon us. Bless tonight's gathering. Bless the food we're going to receive. Let it be nourishment to us. Bless our conversations. Bless the mission of JMI, that we will continue to do that. We honor you. Amen.
We're having a color guard coming through here in a second. There we go. Please stand.
Thank you.
join me in giving these gentlemen a round of applause? And you may have a seat. That was Cub Scout Pack 118 and Boy Scout Troop 118. Just terrific. Just terrific. One more person slipped in that I didn't get a chance to introduce, both personally and professionally, a terrific friend from the Department of Economic Opportunity, their executive director, Jesse Panuccio, from the governor's office. I'd like to ask Board Member Stan Conley to come forward and introduce our next speaker.
Well, good evening. It's wonderful to see the room so full tonight. It's an honor to be here. As Bob said, I'm Stan Connolly. I'm a JMI board member. I'm also the president and CEO of Gulf Power Company in Pensacola, and we're very honored to be a sponsor tonight. I'm looking forward to introducing our speaker before we go to our dinner intermission, and after this speaker, you can certainly enjoy time with the guests at your table. Our next speaker, much like Bob, is a fifth-generation Floridian. He has grown up in this state and made a mark in this state already in a number of very short years, frankly. He grew up in the citrus and the cattle industry. He served in the Florida House of Representatives. Then he served our state and our country in the 12th Congressional District in Washington for a number of terms. And since then has come home to make a big difference and to continue serving our state as our Commissioner of Agriculture. And for those of you who didn't know, our agricultural industry in this state is a $120 billion business, $120 billion impact to this state, and it certainly serves so many families so well in the state of Florida. He's also an outdoorsman and a believer in supporting our military veterans, and coming from a district that I live in that is the home to so many veterans, in fact, one of the greatest density of veterans per capita of any congressional district in this country, I can relate to his passion for this. He was critical in starting Operation Outdoor Freedom that provides outdoor opportunities to hunt, to fish, to recreate in state forests and state lands. And so far, I understand over 300 veterans have been able to participate in that program. As you know, if you're following anything relative to policy right now, he is a passionate advocate for doing the right thing around water policy in our state. And you're already seeing policy proposals and recommendations around water quality and water quantity, and I'm confident we're going to move the ball forward. If you're like me, you were incredibly proud to watch he and his family take the stage in January and be sworn in for his second term as our Commissioner of Agriculture. I'm not a fifth generation Floridian. I've actually only been here 3 years. But I can tell you... But to see leaders like Adam Putnam take that stage and raise his right hand and represent this state in leadership makes me proud to call Florida home. Please welcome me in joining Commissioner Adam Putnam.
Wow. Thank you, Stan. I think I'm in love. Between that introduction and Alan Bent's cheering every time we get introduced, I've got my traveling posse with me. It's a treat to be here and to be the warm-up act for the grand event. I feel like the Polk County Jug Band warming up for U2 and the Rolling Stones between Jeff Atwater and Stephen Hayes. But it is a treat to just share a few thoughts with you and be sort of the amuse-bouche before your meal. And speaking of that, we got to get on the caterer. You could glue all those berries back together and you'd only have half of a Plant City strawberry per glass. Isn't that right, Dan Rollerson? But I'm here to talk about the Florida story. And the Florida story doesn't even begin in Florida. I mean, Stan, if he were living anywhere in Florida except Pensacola, he'd be a native. I mean, in Palm Beach, they'd be running him for mayor. But in Pensacola, he's still got five or six generations to go. But the Florida story doesn't begin in Florida. The Florida story begins in places like Boston, where people are shoveling 9 feet of snow, dreaming that one day they're going to be able to come to Florida and play golf in January and have a place on the beach. The Florida story begins in the mayoral offices of Bill de Blasio, who's done more for economic development than we could ever dream. The Florida story begins in Rahm's office in Chicago. It begins in a traffic jam in the Northeast where people just have a death grip on a steering wheel and their temples are throbbing with high blood pressure, thinking about one day being in Florida. And when they write that last tuition check and the last baby leaves the nest, and they turn to their spouse and say, the next one's for us. But the Florida story also begins in places like Paris, when the government lifts the income tax on their highest, most entrepreneurial earners that are left in that country, and the phones start ringing off the hook in places like Miami Beach. The Florida story is in Caracas, or in Cartagena, or in Havana, where people seek the opportunity to live in a place where property rights are still sacred, where freedom is secured, and where opportunities are limitless. And so the Florida story that begins all over the world comes to this wonderful peninsula. And we know that at some point in the most successful people around the world's lives, they're going to end up here. But I believe that the next iteration of the Florida story, the next chapter of the Florida story, is about how we get those same talented, entrepreneurial people 40 years sooner so that they decide to make Florida not the reward, not the prize for a life well lived someplace else, but the place that they will use as the gateway to the American dream, that they will raise their family here, build their business here, grow out their manufacturing, discover the next big thing, find their dreams in Florida, so that in addition to understanding what a prize it really is to live here, they'll be passionately, emotionally invested in the long-term good of Florida. Because when they're shoveling snow or when they're sitting in traffic, they're not thinking about what Florida's water policy ought to be or how much we ought to put into the I-4 widening project or how we continue to lift standards and give parents and students more options in education, because that's not part of the dream. But if we're going to fulfill our Florida vision, if we're going to write the next chapter of that Florida story, we have to have policymakers and citizens who are fully invested in the long-term vision for Florida, the long-term good of Florida, so that the young men represented by the Boy Scout Color Guard don't have to go to Austin or Boston or Silicon Valley or Atlanta or Charlotte to find their piece of the American dream. They'll find it in their own backyard. They'll find it in Miami or Tampa or Jacksonville, or if they're really lucky, they'll find it in Bartow. That's the Florida story. That's the next chapter of the Florida story. And it's still unfolding, and it's still being written. And we can't forget how fortunate we are to live in a state where, despite being the most diverse and the third most populous, we still have an unabashedly pro-business, pro-free enterprise, pro-property rights state government in charge. And that's fragile. That's fragile. New York's lost it. Ohio's lost it. They're trying to get it back. Illinois's lost it. They've got a $111 billion pension liability. California hadn't had it since Reagan left. But Florida still has it. And we must fiercely protect it. And so as that Florida story continues to unfold, it's up to us to determine whether it will be paved with wisdom or with ignorance, whether we'll make the long-term commitments and investments to make it a better place, or whether we'll accept the short-term patches and band-aids and sacrifices that got those other states where they find themselves today. I believe in the Florida story, and I believe in the future of our state. And thanks to organizations like JMI, we will continue to be on the high road for free enterprise, opportunity, liberty, and fulfilling the American dream right here in the Sunshine State. Thank you very much.
We're going to go ahead and get started with the second part of our program. You continue to eat and enjoy the night, but we have a fascinating and interesting evening ahead of us. So we're going to go ahead and get started with the second part. Before I do, I've been fortunate enough to be here at the Institute for about 10 and a half years, hired by Charles Hilton, many of whom you know. Charles stepped down about 6 years ago for health reasons, and then I've had Alan Bench as my board chairman for nearly five. But with all that we do, you've been introduced to the staff, you've been introduced to my terrific board of directors, but the real power behind the throne is someone who allows me to do this job, and that's my wife of 22 years, Julie McClure. So thank you, honey. I'd like to ask board member Jeff Swain from Tallahassee to come here.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here with you all tonight. I'm Jeff Swain, a JMI board member from here in Tallahassee, and it's been my pleasure to serve on the JMI board for 10 years or so and experience firsthand all the good work that we at James Madison Institute are doing for the people of Florida. One policy priority that we have here at JMI is educational choice. Of Florida's 3.5 million kindergarten through 12th grade students, approximately 42% attended a school of their choice during the last school year. Florida has the largest school choice program in the country, with more than 1 million children experiencing some form of school choice in Florida. As these programs have come under attack recently, JMI launched into action, along with several other organizations, to protect the rights of parents and students to maintain their choice, a full school choice, and to realize their full potential. As part of this effort, JMI released a short film in February focused on a young man whose life changed after he found a school that welcomed him and his special needs. This is just one story among the millions in Florida that captures the change in a child when they finally found the educational option that meets their needs. We present to you, Sharp Mind, Noble Heart, the story of Valentin Mendez.
My name is Valentin Mendez. I am in the 10th grade. I am 16 years old and I attend to La Progresiva Presbyterian School. Before I attended La Progresiva and came here, I was really, really in a bad situation. I was being bullied because I didn't really speak the language. Nobody respected me because I was Hispanic.
He was struggling in the public school predominantly because he just didn't fit in. He struggled and he was bullied and teased because of it, and he just felt like a failure.
Lo llegaba a dejar a clase y los niños venían y tiraban una bola dentro del agua sucia y me lo llenaban todo de agua sucia. Y ya lo último fue que tuvo un problema bien serio en escuela, me lo agarraron y me lo golpearon y nadie me dijo nada. Nadie me llamó.
She moved him from one school to another school predominantly because nothing was happening. She starts searching and searching and searching. She finds out about the scholarship. She comes into our school building and she asks the secretary, I don't know what you're going to do for me, but I need help.
After everything that I went through, I came to La Progresiva and it was a miracle.
La Progresiva originated back in Cardenas, Cuba in 1900. In the late 50s, when the Castro regime took over, La Progresiva in Cuba closed its doors forever. 10 years later, a group of ex-alumni decide it's time that we recharge this vision that Dr. Warden had, and the school now reemerges in the city of Miami.
I started fifth grade, and I came into the school in February 14th. Valentine's Day, Day of Love, And like, I felt loved by everybody in the school.
And it was almost as if a light had gone on. And you saw this change in pretty much everything that Valentin, his everyday actions.
Para mí era Valentin con muchas tareas. Valentin en todo. Valentin en deporte. El ambiente era otro. Nadie me lo golpeaba. Nadie me lo miraba mal.
Valentin's life pretty much changed. The majority of the kids, they all come from a Spanish-speaking home. A lot of their parents don't speak any English, don't understand any English. However, they've come to this country to thrive and to build a future for their children. The vast majority of these students are on some type of scholarship. And without the scholarship, the students wouldn't be able to attend a private school.
Students that are in the Step Up for Students scholarship program are doing at level, or if not better in some cases, than their peers, or where they should be at their grade level. So that's obviously very encouraging to see. Valentin is a great example of that story, and Valentin is just one of thousands of stories that we see here throughout the state of Florida. Unfortunately, we have a lawsuit that's standing filed by the Florida Education Association, FEA, against the Step Up for Students Scholarship Program. If successful, we're talking about 70,000 students, just like Valentin, that unfortunately would have to be taken out of the school of their choice and have to pick a school that's in their district that in many cases they've left to attend a better school. Our organization, Hispanic Creo, along with many other organizations, are working hard against this lawsuit and obviously urging the Florida Education Association to drop that suit.
Without Step Up, I wouldn't be here. Here, I really feel like I have a future. I have a future because I'm learning.
El programa de Step Up para mí es todo.
Schools like La Progresiva would be tremendously hurt if this lawsuit is successful. And ironically enough, back in Cuba, where La Progresiva was founded and started, was closed down by the Castro regime. And here in Florida, if again this lawsuit is successful, would be closed down by the Florida Education Association.
We were called to participate in the Hispanic Creo Summit. Valentin was even able to speak at the dinner as one of the main speakers. Once we were leaving the summit, Valentin had told me, "Miss, I really want to take my mom some flowers." He was just so overwhelmed by everything that he was like, "I want my mom to have something from this." So he presented his mom with the flowers from the flower arrangement at our table.
Cada vez que veo detalles de Valentín así me llena de orgullo porque tiene un corazón muy bueno, es muy noble.
Wow, what a powerful story. We have another special guest with us here tonight who is very passionate about this issue, and we're honored to have him take time out of his busy schedule in order to join us. Jeff Atwater, Florida Chief Financial Officer, is a true public servant with a deep love of our great state. He's a true conservative and with a principled approach to leadership. The CFO, like President Bob, is also a fifth-generation Floridian. His commitment to Florida public service began in 1993 when his hometown of North Palm Beach elected him vice mayor. He was subsequently elected to the House of Representatives in 2000 and the Florida Senate in 2002, and was unanimously selected by his fellow senators to serve as Senate president in 2008. His private sector experiences, which included 25 years of community banking, provide him with unique and valuable perspective on the sacrifices and challenges facing the businessmen and women of Florida, as well as the impact of government on the individuals and families of this state. Now, to share with us his Florida story and more on his desire to see parental and student choice and education protected, Florida's Chief Financial Officer, Jeff Atwater.
Thanks so much, Jeff. Thanks so much. Very kind. Thank you. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you very much. A pleasure to be with you all tonight. I should make a clarification on the bio. I was unanimously elected Senate President on the second ballot. Let me say, I'm excited about the conversation that I've been asked to have with you tonight on school choice. and on school accountability in the Florida story. But it does really begin, as earlier said, the thank you is to you. So Chairman Benz to you, the Speaker Benz into the board, and to the Bob to your team. And all of you who may be associated, it is a deep sense of gratitude we share with you. Those of us given a unique moment in time, a brief window to offer ourselves in the world of policymakers, we thank you. You have armed us and you have burdened us with the information that we can go into these battles and debates. It's fine if somebody wants to ignore the facts in front of them, but you provide us with those facts with a deep commitment and interest to the outcome. So to all of you in JMI, I say thank you. So let me share a story with you. It is the late 1990s, and I'll be quick about this. I'm returning to my hometown where I grew up as a kid, and I am now taking my kids to the elementary school I went to when I was in elementary school, growing up in that same town. I thought I'd attend the PTA meeting. I went to the PTA meeting. I sat in the same cafeteria, in a similar spot in the same cafeteria where I was often escorted to the principal's office. The principal was here in front of a stage. The teachers were on the stage sitting behind the principal, and those of us parents were there in the cafeteria. And the principal shared with us this passionate argument, saying, "Are you paying attention to the election? There is this guy named Jeb Bush running for office. And he, in fact, wants to take the standards that are out there and actually put metrics to those and publish the outcome in the paper. And if, in fact, a school underperforms for 2 years in a row, the parents could make a choice where to send their child, and the money will follow them. We must act." And the parents, the teachers on the stage behind her were nodding. A little bit of us in the audience were certainly perplexed. And she said, "But think about this. If this happens in 2 to 3 years, these corridors will be empty. We'll have but a few students still here. We won't have the money to take care of your child. And this is just the beginning. Imagine what will happen to graduation rates. And then one thing will lead to another. And then the families that can will take their children. And we'll be left with the leftovers. Next thing you know, they'll be helping kids with disabilities. And we'll be left with the families who couldn't make a choice. Or the Hispanic kids whose parents didn't have a choice will be left with the leftovers." I was stunned. I was thought, how could she just insult every teacher behind her? I was hoping she was going to say, "Did you hear about this guy? Let's get behind this because the teachers behind me are the most exceptional in the state. And I tell you what, if this passes, parents will be knocking down the door to be coming to this school because I care about the future of your child. Let us compete." That's what I was hoping she would say. Well, the evening ended, and she was making her way around, and I hadn't left. I was catching up with some old friends, and she said, as she got to me, as I think she was saying to every parent, "Did you receive my call to action? Will you get up? Will you get engaged?" And I said, "I will. I intend to run for the state legislature and vote for everything you talked about tonight." So let's just take a step back just earlier, 1995. Things were starting to change in Florida. I know this is a nonpartisan gathering, so I'm going to just leave it at that. Things were starting to change in Florida. A Florida Senate had a new philosophy about some accountability ideas. And shortly thereafter, the Florida House changed in a way that it was not only accepting those, but very aggressively embracing these new ideas about choice, about what it's like for someone to sacrifice and build a small business, about what it could be if we could get out of people's way and let them loose with their dreams. And then in 1998, we had another change in the role of the governor of the state. And yes, the A-plus plan was introduced that said, if your school does not achieve by these standards, after 2 years in a row, you can make the choice. You can go where you believe is best for your child. That may be a private school. It may be a school right down the street, but you have a choice as a parent. You know, when we look back, let's not forget about how difficult that fight was. It was not preordained. It was not in the bag. It was a fight for the ages because there were institutional players who understood if Florida gets away with this, who might be next? If this one little crack in the armor of our institution of the system starts to crack, what will crack next? Well, there were other cracks. That went into place and it was fought immediately in the courts. But what followed that was a commitment to supporting parents and homeschooling choices that they would make, resources that they would need, partnerships that they could have.
What followed that were what we call the McKay Scholarship. That the parent of a child with a learning disability or a disability could make a choice where to send a child that they believe would be the best answer for their educational needs with the disability they were challenged with. And then came the corporate tax scholarship program that you heard Valentin just speak of. That low-income families could have access to dollars provided by corporations that would send their dollars to an education foundation so that parent could make a choice. And then came virtual schooling. Why not allow a parent sitting any place in Florida to pick out that person who is tops in that field to take on their child's needs? And then came the fight for social promotion. If you could not read by the end of the third grade, at third grade level, you were staying. And then we'd provide you with the tutors so that you'd be ready for the fourth grade when the fourth grade came around the next year, because it was far more important that you could read. All of these things have been part of the building blocks of this Florida story. But let me return you to 1995. In 1995, Florida ranked 45th in fourth grade reading by the national norm test, not our test, the national norm test. And we were below 60% in our high school graduation rates. This is what the system was fighting to defend. But would disturb you just as much, and you were there, every Rotary, every Kiwanis, every Optimist Club, where legislators would go to speak, they were asked but one question about K through 12. How much more did you spend this year than last year? That was the only benchmark. For two decades, on average, the legislature was spending three times more in every K through 12 new year than the prior year, over the rate of inflation, over any other economic indicator. We were spending more, and when you said that, you got an applause while we slid into the abyss. All those fights, and Speaker Benz, when I stand and tell the story, there are those, why there is humility here and with me tonight as I'm looking around at people that paid a heavy price for every vote and all those fights, but they believed in it. Don Brown believed in it. So what's happened? We were 45th, but with A+, it started to move. The numbers started to change. You know, we do this national norm test every other year. This is, again, not our test. We cannot cook the books. The national norm test. We started to move, and we started to climb. With A+, those systems understood we have to now fight for these children. We have to perform. We're held accountable now. Someone's watching. It's measured. It's in the paper at the end of every year. A, B, C, D, F. We have to now go to bat. How good was that? And the McKay Scholarship. Yes, parents began to take advantage of it. And the corporate tax scholarship. Companies began to hear the story. You mean I could do that for kids in my community? Yes, you can. So here's the update. The state was 45th in the country in 1995. After these reforms and all these battles took place last year, fourth grade reading, 45th, now second in the world. That's your students. Now, here's the disclaimer. Not every state had the courage at the beginning of the testing process to put their kids against the world. We did. So on the national norm test, just among the 50 states, we now rank 8th. But I'll tell you what, I'll take 45th to 8th. But here's the rest of the story. It wasn't just a one-time thing. These last 2 years, just these past 2 years, our fourth grade and our eighth grade reading scores were twice the improvement of the national average score. Our eighth grade reading scores were twice the improvement of the national average movement. We had, over that period of time, those 10 years that I spoke of, the second best improvement in the country in our learning gains. And I didn't mention eighth grade math. We now, this past year, three times outperformed the learning gains of the national average. That's our students in our classrooms. And you know what? Those are the ones, those institutions, and I'll make it clear, the Florida Education Association and the Florida School Board Association. These are the kids they call the left behinds. Because in homeschooling today, 77,000 children are in homeschooling in Florida. In the Corporate Tax Scholarship Initiative, what Valentin is in, 69,000 children are now in the Step Up for Children program. McKay Scholarships, 29,000. 33,000 full-time virtual school students, which means the scores I just gave you were not theirs. It was the 2.7 million who are in those public schools. It is their performance that I'm speaking of. It is their future potential that I speak of. That's why the fight was worthwhile. And talking about the gaps, the number one reading scores in fourth grade for Hispanic students, the number one state in the union is Florida. The number one state, the number one state in the union for children of household, the child with disability, the number one state in the union, Florida. Children designated as low and income household, the number one state in the union, Florida. That's the difference. Graduation rates. Our graduation rates over that 10-year period have improved 25%. Our graduation rates over that period of time are the second best improvement in graduation rates in the country. Our graduation rates today in Florida are the best they have ever been in Florida history. So, why this story is so important? The principal said to me that night, for me to get engaged, because it's every child's future that's at stake. And then if you take about every child in every house on our street, it's the very future of our states and its ability to compete and prosper is at stake. Every one of these initiatives that has advanced the opportunity for our children to succeed and compete in the world is under assault as we speak right now. So might I ask of you what my principal asked of me? Can we deepen our engagement? Will we stay for this fight? Will we understand the consequences and the outcomes that will come if any of these are chipped away, or heaven forbid, they're removed from the public policy integrated tapestry of who we are now as Floridians? It is our responsibility. And as was said earlier, it is all so fragile. It is our time to ensure that the battles that were fought and the political fights that were had and the gains that we have made for the next generation become not just a gift to the future generation of Florida's children, but let them indeed be exported as the finest ideas and the finest gifts that we can give to the next generation. That is our story. You encouraged us to go create it. And I'm here just to tell you, you had the right ideas. You had the right evidence, and now let's be sure no one takes it away from the kids of Florida. Thank you so much. Good to be with you.
Thank you, CFO Atwater. We are all so very grateful to you for all your many efforts on behalf of the people of Florida. Thank you again. I'm Becky Liner, the Executive Vice President of the James Madison Institute. You've heard us use words tonight like engage, empower, educate, equip. And I want to speak to you briefly about two ways that we at JMI, that we put those words into action in our efforts to reach the next generation. Through the Preston A. Wells Jr. Center for American Ideals, JMI has established an engaging civics education program that since its inception in 2008 has reached approximately 750,000, let me say that again, 750,000 young people in the state of Florida. We do that through programs including our Celebrate Freedom and All About the Benjamins curriculum that we publish in cooperation with newspapers in education. Through historic reenactors who personify James and Dolly Madison, Benjamin Franklin, Patrick Henry, Abraham Lincoln, and John Wesley. Through a game show that we developed for fifth graders that uses Benjamin Franklin, the reenactor, and he talks about his values of thrift. Through presentations at Girls State, Boys State, and Youth Leadership Tallahassee. And through Constitution Day lectures around the state of Florida that featured our country's best constitutional scholars. Our second center is aimed at youth outreach, is the Barney and Carol Barnett Young Leaders Center, through which JMI operates a vibrant college internship program. Every semester, year in and year out, we have the best and brightest of college students working with us here in Tallahassee. An average of 20 to 25 interns each year. That's over 200 young people just in the last 10 years alone. Now, those are just the ones who got accepted into the program. It's a really competitive, highly selective process, and we have over 100 applicants just every year. Our interns have represented virtually every college and university in the state of Florida, as well as many of the most academically well-respected institutions around the country. They represent a wide variety of majors, from those that you would expect, economics, political science, to the unexpected, hospitality and sports management. I'd like to draw your attention to this graphic. The stars represent just a few of the places that our interns have gone on to work around the country and around the world. So our interns can be found in the most unusual places. I'd like to introduce you to one of those interns now. Lecrae Mitchell is a senior at Florida A&M University, majoring in broadcast journalism and minoring in Spanish. Lecrae interned with us in 2012. In 2013, she co-produced a nationally acclaimed news magazine show that won an Academy of Television Arts and Sciences Students Emmy. Last year, Lecrae interned with CNN in Atlanta, where she served as an international news source intern. After studying abroad in Madrid to complete her Spanish minor, she then interned with CBS News in New York as an investigative unit intern, and she's been invited to return to CBS again this summer. She is currently the editor-in-chief of FAMU's award-winning student magazine, Journey, and she also serves as the vice president of the university's presidential ambassadors. Lecrae, will you come tell us a little bit about your internship experience?
Thank you very, very much, Ms. Leiner. It would be my pleasure to share with everyone how much the James Madison Institute has impacted me. My story, I thought it was very interesting. And in the spirit of keeping with the theme, my Florida story spans back 21 years. I was born and raised here in Tallahassee, Florida. So I am a true Floridian. And I wouldn't be serving anyone justice if I didn't mention how much of an important factor the James Madison Institute has played in my Florida story. I met Ms. Leiner and Mr. Maddox when I was in 10th grade. And the occasion was that I was running for Tallahassee mayor. With the Tallahassee Youth Leadership Program, I had been selected as one of the few 11th graders here in Leon County to run a mock mayoral candidate race. And I gave a speech. And after losing to my opponent, Mr. Maddox approached me and he said, "I know that the ballots may not have shown that you were a winner, but you definitely stood out to us." And since that moment, I've been in constant communication with them, and they've kind of taken me in. And so my sophomore year of college, I had the pleasure and the esteemed honor of serving as one of their interns at the James Madison Institute. I Everyone has their favorite maxim in life, and mine, one of my favorites, has always been, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously allow others permission to do the same. And as we're liberated from our own fears, our presence, just our presence, automatically liberates others. And I can truly say that my experience at JMI was a liberating one. From the moment that I stepped in through those doors, I felt the warmth and encouragement of all of the employees there and the staff, and I felt like I was right at home. Whether I was honing in on writing skills, working on newsletters, and learning how to become a more creative writer so that I could use those skills at CNN and CBS later on down the line. Every experience at JMI has definitely made me the woman that I am today. The woman that stands before you and says that interning with JMI was one of the best experiences of my life. And it definitely served as the foundation to go on and do bigger and greater things in life. And so as I get ready to step down, I'd just like to say that out of all of the things that JMI provided me, a great network of people who really care about me and make sure that I always know that they can be there for a letter of recommendation or just someone to talk to. And on top of learning, like I said, learning from some of the most knowledgeable and the most intelligent people that I know, the most important thing that I think I took away from interning with the James Madison Institute was becoming a better me. And I think that that's powerful because it definitely is the tone and the main idea of my Florida story. Thank you very much.
Thank you, LaCrae. I don't think we all have any doubt that she's going to be a success at whatever she chooses to do. Do you? LaCrae's story is just one of the dozens that we have heard throughout the years with our interns at the James Madison Institute. We're fortunate tonight to have a large group of those former and current interns with us. And I'd like to ask all of you to please stand now. And we want to recognize you for the many ways you've engaged the culture and helped us to succeed. These are some of the greatest young people in the state of Florida, and it has been my absolute honor to work with each and every one of you. We wish you nothing but success in whatever you choose to do, where you take your gifts and talents. And truly, JMI would not be who we are today without all the contributions you've made to us. Thank you so very much. I'm going to turn the podium over now to our JMI board member, Glenn Blau. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Becky. And LaCrae, what a, I think we can all agree, what an impressive young lady she is and what has been accomplished. Yes, please. My name is Glenn Blau, and I'm a board member with JMI, and I hail from the beautiful place of Naples, Florida. And it's, although it took about 6.5 hours to drive up here today, you realize what a long and beautiful state we actually have. I've been involved with JMI for a number of years. And just being able to sit back and having some time to reflect and to see really what kind of growth that our institute has had and the influence and the outreach that has been assessed to a wide variety of people across this beautiful state that we have. It's something we're proud of, and it's something where it's the foundation where we're going to continue on. Now onward. It was about a year and a half ago, I had the privilege of having Stephen Hayes come down to Naples, Florida for a JMI event. And what a wonderful time that it was. We had a luncheon that was at the Ritz-Carlton, and that evening a number of the donors came over and to our home, Sandra's and my home, and we had Stephen there. And he flirted around all the different tables, and everyone was impressed. And everyone in Naples, Florida wants him to come back. So I assure you, you're going to have a fun evening tonight with him. He's a family man, an impassioned conservative. And I sometimes marvel at him, now that I've gotten the chance to know him, how difficult that must be, 2, 3, 4 times a week, being on Fox News and the All-Stars, to be up against Charles Krauthammer and George Will. And he's able to look them right in the eye and do it. I told him tonight that I watch very carefully when the cameras work, how I see Krauthammer look over at him when he speaks. Most people, when they're speaking, I see him looking straight ahead and being prepared to go on. And I think that speaks very well for Stephen Hayes. He's, and it's a privilege for me to be able to introduce him tonight. He's a senior writer. Stephen Hayes is a senior writer with the Weekly Standard and a Fox News contributor, where he's a regular member of the Fox All-Stars and Network Signature, which is their signature broadcast. His work has featured also in the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, the New York Times, Los Angeles Times, The Reason Magazine, National Review, and many other publications. And he's been a commentator with CNN, the McLaughlin Group, CNBC, as well as C-SPAN. He has written extensively about national politics, international affairs, and is one becoming, and has been, in my opinion, the country's current political leadership commentator. Just a show of around the room, how many get a chance to watch Stephen Hayes occasionally on Fox News? And I knew that was going to happen. There may have been one or two hands that didn't go up. So with me, it's almost like watching Stephen Hayes now that I've gotten to see him. And isn't it a wonderful thing that you can record now so that you, if you come home late, you can watch it at 11 o'clock. But to be able to see him come and on particularly difficult days in the news, to be able to have him talk, it's oh my goodness, it's like mother and apple pie and vanilla ice cream. Glad to have him with us. He was one of the first to report regarding Mitt Romney and that he was going to be having Paul Ryan as his running mate. Very first to come out on it. And of course, as we follow the news, some of you know that it was him, it was Stephen Hayes that really, through the Weekly Standard, to be able to go out and really bring about the issues of Benghazi. And we're seeing the impact of that today. So that has been there. He's also a New York Times bestseller. If you haven't, read some of his book, one of his books, Cheney, he had written. And it's the untold story of America's most powerful and controversial vice president. And then the next one is The Connection, where he was talking about Al-Qaeda's collaboration with Saddam Hussein and how it endangered America. And we're seeing the results of some of that today. So tonight, I'm just very proud to be able to bring him up here. We're going to be doing it a little differently. We're going to be bringing our CEO and our president and our beloved leader, Dr. Robert McClure, up. And we're going to, instead of having a keynote speaker, we're going to be having more of a TV network set up. It's almost like the male version of The View, I guess, is what we're going to have. and so with that said, I am delighted to be introducing to you Stephen Hayes and Dr. Robert McClure.
Well, here we are. Glenn called it The View, could be The Oprah Show, whichever you prefer.
If it were outnumbered, I'd have to show some legs.
Yeah.
Or the five.
We're going downhill fast. No, really glad you're here. We want
to,
this is
going to
be here. It's going to be a lot of give and take, a lot of opportunities. We've had some questions tweeted in. We've also had some index cards, but we got to start first. You flew through Panama City.
Correct.
Not Tallahassee.
Correct.
Okay. Is there a reason Is there a reason why you flew through Panama City and not Tallahassee?
I should have known this was coming. That's actually a true story. I was on the terrorist watch list. I was on the terrorist watch list for about 6 weeks. Yeah, this is not why I flew through Panama City, but I was on the terrorist watch list because I had flown a one-way trip to Turkey, to Istanbul, Turkey, to do the Hillsdale College cruise last summer. My wife went along with me. She somehow didn't make it on the terrorist watch list, but it was hilarious. The first time I got stopped was at an airport in Milwaukee, and I walked up to the woman. I gave her my boarding pass, and if you're on the watch list, you have these $4 signs at the bottom of your... I'm probably giving away national security secrets, but that's how you know. And I didn't know what they meant. I thought maybe they think I'm money. But I was looking at this thing, and I gave it to this young woman who was scanning these things. She flashed it under the scanner, and this alarm goes off, like full alarm. The whole thing goes, and she panics. I'm scared, but she's terrified. She thinks she's looking at a terrorist. And she calls over the supervisor of the whole thing. They shut down my lane. They shut down the entire area. And they do the full search. They go through my toilet kit. They go through everything I've got. Anyway, I eventually made it through. This happened to me now then every time I traveled for 6 weeks. And one time, the guy who did it to me took me aside. And he's like, yeah, you know, Mr. Hayes, I'm sorry I've got to do this to you. I like to watch you on Fox. I said, really? You still think I'm a terrorist? But the whole thing ends. This is a true story. It's very funny. Maybe some of you saw this on Brett Baer's show. So Brett gets an interview with Jay Johnson, who's the Secretary of Homeland Security. And Brett and I are old college buddies. We went to college together. We're good friends. We often sort of trade thoughts on issues of the day or perspective questions. And so I sent Brett a few questions about what he might ask Jay Johnson. It was a series of very serious questions, you know, border control and, you know, is Hezbollah infiltrating the southern border? And then the last question I sent Brett was, hey, ask him if he knows that I'm on the list and if he thinks I'm a terrorist. So I send it to Brett. I'm in the green room at the time at Fox, so I'm 100 yards away from where they're actually conducting this interview. I sent this to Brett. I didn't think he was actually going to do it. So Brett takes the question and deadpans it. And it's perfect. He just nails it. He gets very serious, sort of looks at Mr. Secretary, as you might be aware, Stephen Hayes, a Fox News contributor, often appears on this panel, is on the terrorist watch list. And then he looks at him with a total serious face. Do you think Steve Hayes is a terrorist? And the whole thing is like a send-up, right? I mean, it's a joke. Like, of course I'm not a terrorist. Of course he's going to laugh. Jay Johnson didn't laugh at all. And he looks, Brett's sort of like got that dimply smile that he has. And he looks back at, and Jay Johnson looks at Brett, and he's totally serious. And he says, Brett, I can't speak to Steve Hayes' situation. As if I'm a terrorist. Like, what? Anyway, sorry, that was a longer answer than you wanted, but
that's perfect.
No, I'm off the list. I'm free to travel. I need to do the TSA pre-check. It'll get me through a little bit faster.
Gotcha.
Haven't done it yet.
Great. Okay, we're going to start with really two hard questions. We did this last year too. The first one is really hard. If tragedy were to befall you, okay, and you were dropped onto a desert island with one MSNBC commentator. Who would it be and why?
That is a good question. So I'll confess by saying that Chuck Todd, who was at MSNBC and is now the host of Meet the Press, is an old friend. He hired me when I worked at the Hotline, National Journal's publication in Washington. So he's a buddy. So in reality, I'd probably pick Chuck and take a couple of cases of beer. And he's also a Green Bay Packers fan, as I am, so we'd talk about the Packers. But probably, and this will surprise maybe some of you, probably my choice would be Rachel Maddow.
Ooh. You got some explaining to do.
I've got a little history with Rachel Maddow. So before I was at Fox, I was at CNN for a while. And before I was at CNN, believe it or not, I was at MSNBC. And I was on a show every day, 6 p.m. I was on the 6 p.m. show on MSNBC. Then I was on the 6 p.m. show at CNN. And then I jumped to Fox, where I've been for 6 years. But the 6 p.m. show at CNBC or at MSNBC was at the time called The Road to White House, and it was hosted by David Gregory. And the panel was, I mean, it was sort of typical MSNBC, right? It was David Gregory, three liberals, and me. And, you know, I was the guy that everybody beat up on. And I loved it. I mean, it was a fun sort of challenge. But the show started every time. They wanted to begin the show with energy. And that's all, cable TV is all about energy. And everybody's in your ear, it's energy, we need energy. So this show was to start with energy, and David Gregory would always kick it off with this 45 seconds of quick, you know, rapid fire. Here's what's happening in the race to the White House, and very fast. And then he would throw to a panelist. And you'd have basically 30 seconds to give your thoughts on whatever the news of the day was. And, you know, usually who he threw to, who he sent it to was, you know, jumped around. But at one point, it started always going to Rachel Maddow. And she was on this panel. And she was sort of a newbie, like nobody knew her. And David Gregory would do his energetic 45 seconds, and then he'd throw to Rachel Maddow. And she was awesome. Her stuff was like perfect, perfectly formed sentences, you know, perfect paragraphs, just beautiful presentation. She made her point. She always finished with a flourish. Like her final sentence was this great kicker of a sentence. And then he'd throw to me, and I would sort of stumble and bumble my way through my answer and then go to somebody else. Well, I later found out that MSNBC was grooming this young Rachel Maddow for a position at the network. And David Gregory read off the teleprompter, and then Rachel Maddow read off the teleprompter. And then they threw to me to be the idiot. So I just sort of babbled on. So she was, not to say that she isn't good. I mean, she can make very good arguments when she's not on teleprompter, but it definitely helps if you've got it written out.
And say so. Yeah.
So anyway, I'd want to be on the desert island to sort of get her back, because there are no teleprompters on a desert island.
Gotcha. I hear you. Good one. One more really, really serious one, and then we'll get to the semi-serious. Okay, you're a Washington guy. You've been there forever. How real is House of Cards?
So first of all, I didn't insult you. Why'd you call me a Washington
guy?
That's
true. I stand corrected.
I'm a Wisconsin guy.
Yeah.
May it someday be a Florida guy.
Come on down.
Yeah. That's not pandering, actually. That's true. So I had no interest in watching House of Cards until Charles Krauthammer once, during a commercial break, suggested that we watch it. It was this great show. It was new. It was at the time that everybody was talking about it. Everybody was sort of buzzing about it. We don't watch a ton of TV, and when we watch TV, I feel like Adam Putnam was sort of channeling me with his comments, because I'm the guy who's driving in traffic and shoveling the snow and wanting to be warm places. So when we watch TV, this is a little probably more information than you wanted, we watch a lot of HGTV, and so we watch Beachfront Bargain Hunt and a lot of House Hunters International, Caribbean Life. Yeah, I mean, it's not that I don't like what I'm doing in Washington, but you know, you imagine yourself these other places. So we watch a fair amount of that stuff and don't watch a ton of other TV. But Charles Krauthammer, during a commercial break, we had this long discussion about things to watch. He recommended one show that is brilliant and wonderful, and we watch it to this day, called Foyle's War. It's a PBS show. It's a British show. It's fantastic. I can't recommend it highly enough. And Charles was exactly right about that, and he'd recommended it a while ago. So I thought, he was right about that. I'll listen to him on this one. The other show he recommended was House of Cards. And so we watched the first episode. Interesting, suspenseful, you know. Second show, sort of the same way. Third show, kind of souring on it. Fourth show, done. Totally done. Hated the show. It's not at all. Look, I think a lot of bad things about Washington, but it's not that. And it was totally unrealistic. And I think because I work in that all day, every day, and recognize how bad Washington is on substantive stuff, that to see it fictionalized that way was sort of silly and unrealistic. And so I stopped watching it after 3.5 episodes.
Good to know. Good. That's great. All right. Let's talk some policy. Obamacare. Let's just kind of touch on Obamacare. I would say there's a palpable frustration, not only in this room, but across the country with what's happening there. We're a nonpartisan organization, but it seems that one party seems to run in opposition to it, but when they get to Washington, nothing really gets done. I realize they don't have the White House. Yeah. What do you see? I mean, this can't go on indefinitely. It's been a disaster across the board. What do you see as the future of Obamacare, realistically, and what can be done? What do you think, or do you think we're sentenced to this for the rest of our lives?
How do you really feel?
What do you see? With the Republicans there, its future in Washington, is there anything the states can do? What do you see going on with Obamacare?
So let me start by saying, when we talk about repeal and replace, I believe that can happen. I mean, I wouldn't make the repeal and replace argument if I didn't believe it was actually doable. And I think it's doable. So I think that should be the objective. That should be the goal. It remains deeply unpopular. There have been 175 polls taken on Obamacare since Barack Obama started his second term. And do you know how many of those it was viewed by voters as more favorable than less favorable? Zero. Not a single poll. If Republicans can't mount an argument in that context, they can't mount an argument on anything. And I will say I'm a little frustrated by the way that congressional Republicans have handled it, particularly since Republicans have the House and the Senate. You remember there was an interview that John Boehner and Mitch McConnell did together on 60 Minutes with Scott Pelley, sort of at the beginning of the new Congress. And Pelley asked him, I think appropriately and bluntly, what's the Republican plan on health care? And Boehner spent 30 seconds beating up Obamacare, and Mitch McConnell said, we're going to repeal it. And that was sort of it. Right. It wasn't really much of a real response. And shortly after that, I think that started some grousing among Republicans who want to have an alternative. And Speaker Boehner was criticized for that response quite a bit. And a couple days later in an interview, a subsequent interview, he said, look, there will be a Republican alternative. There will be a vote on a Republican alternative in this Congress, which I think is great. I think, conservatives, certainly there's no shortage of free market health care plans. And that's been the case, not just since the Obamacare debate took off. I mean, Republicans and conservatives and libertarians and free market types have had these plans on the shelves in backgrounders and policy papers going back decades. I came to the Weekly Standard via the Heritage Foundation. And I remember we had half a dozen plans in the early 1990s about how to reform healthcare to make it more market friendly. So I think there's a case for an alternative. It looks like there'll be a vote on an alternative. And I think, conservatives, whoever is running for president in 2016 needs to make it a central part of the argument, not just because it's a politically valuable case to make, but because Obamacare is a disaster. I mean, President Obama said yesterday was the fifth anniversary of the signing of the bill, and President Obama said, Obamacare is working better than I expected. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine saying that? If you think back, there was a time after Obamacare launched where it was going through all the troubles with the website. There were problems with the, if you like your plan, you can keep it. And Jimmy Carter came out and criticized the president on this. It doesn't happen every day. Jimmy Carter said, this was his signature achievement, and the implementation of it has been incompetent at best, I think was the Carter phrase. Don't quote me exactly, but I think he said it was incompetent at best. And then Bill Clinton came out and criticized the president on this and said, Mr. President, once you say if you like your plan, you can keep it, you can't very well kick these people off their plans. So the federal government should make good on that promise that the Obama administration made. And you stop and think about it. If Jimmy Carter is criticizing you on competence, and Bill Clinton is going after you on integrity, it's a pretty bad spot.
Well said. Very good. Federal government overreach. The EPA, the Endangered Species Act, Waters of the U.S., FCC, NC, the National Labor Relations Board. What's the role of the states? How can we push back? How can, those in Washington who oppose that, is there anything that can be done? Or are we kind of playing, kind of the old four corners basketball game and for another 2 years?
Yeah, that's a very good way to put it. I mean, I would say in the short term, honestly, to be blunt about it, I think it's more the four corners. I mean, in terms of what can happen, you can file lawsuits, you can encourage your federal legislators to make a case, do what they want. But realistically, what's going to stop the president from further empowering the bureaucracy?
Right.
I mean, we've seen him do it. It's part of the plan. It's what he wants to do. It's what he said he was going to do from the beginning. That's the short-term answer, and it's not very encouraging. The long-term answer, of course, is smaller government.
Right.
Limit the government. Limit the powers of these bureaucracies, these unelected bureaucrats who are making these, either making these decisions or implementing decisions that they're given by the White House, by the executive branch. If the bureaucracies are smaller, there's less that they can do. I mean, there's a certain common sense about this case, and I'm a little frustrated Republicans don't make it more often, conservatives don't make it more often. People talk about inefficiency in the government, inefficiency in the bureaucracies. Well, the best way to have more efficient bureaucracies is to have smaller bureaucracies. Mm-hmm. Or, I mean, my preference in many cases, not to have the bureaucracies at all.
Amen.
I think that's a strong case. It's a case that I think the American people are open to, want to believe, particularly when you look at farmers who have been affected by these EPA regs, I mean, you know, regulating dust, the horror stories. It's funny, you're at the point now, or I'm at the point now, where you're in Washington, and you hear some of these horror stories. You have a conversation with a farmer from Wisconsin, and they talk about, you know, this regulation or that regulation. And so many of these things seem incredible that, as a journalist, there's this old phrase, I won't use the exact phrase, but you're taught to have a very strong BS detector. You know this, Justin. I mean, part of being a good journalist is having a strong BS detector. And you hear these stories about what the bureaucracies are doing, and my BS detector goes off all the time. I think this can't possibly be what the federal government's really doing. And then you check it out, and it's exactly what the federal government is really doing. And it's so discouraging on so many levels, but there's a case to be made, and I think the American people are ready to hear the case.
This is from one of our elected officials in the audience. It's a shameless plug, but it's terrific. Thank you very much for this. What could Washington learn from a state like Florida?
Well, I mean, you've heard a lot tonight, mm-hmm. right? I mean, you've heard a lot about the Florida story. If you look at the rankings that you have from Business Insider or Forbes or the Mercatus Institute about the Florida economy, the Florida government, Florida's cash solvency, and you're talking about top 10, top 5 rankings in virtually every one of these instances. And, you know, I think we heard from CFO Atwater. This happened after fights. And this didn't just happen overnight. This is because there were protracted, long and difficult fights against entrenched interests here in Tallahassee and elsewhere, where a lot of this sort of overbearing government was rolled back. So I'd say that's one that's one place. In another way, in a political way, I think conservatives in Washington could learn from many conservatives here that it's okay to fight for the stuff you believe in. Mm. You don't have to roll over all the time. I'm of course thinking about Medicaid expansion. There's a principled case, and I know people are going to be on all sides of this issue, but there's a principled case against Medicaid expansion. The easy case, the oversimplified case, is Medicaid is broke and it's not going to be sustainable, and the federal government's going to pick up the tab for 3 years, and then the states are going to be left having to fund it in perpetuity, potentially. And states can't afford to pick up that tab. It doesn't make any sense on its face. So that's the sort of the obvious case. More broadly, even if the federal government continued its involvement against what we know is likely to happen, the federal government can't afford to do that. We're $18 trillion in debt. I think it's remarkable to see that you had conservatives here rally to block the expansion of Medicaid and to do it in a way that I think makes, was a case that people accepted and understood. And, you know, the secondary case, I think in some ways it may be the more important case, is if you look at outcomes, you look at results, and I know JMI has done several position papers that have mentioned this in op-eds. If you look at results, I mean, there are a number of studies that suggest that those who are placed on Medicaid don't have better outcomes than people who are uninsured. Why would you want to kick people into that program? It makes no sense.
Terrific. Thank you. That's terrific. Gas is, at least in this county, under $2.50 a gallon. It's a major tax cut for the American consumer. Obviously, it varies in different states and different areas of this state. What does oil and gas exploration mean for the future of this country? And where do you see kind of that policy heading current with this current administration?
Well, there is no policy from the current administration. The current administration's policy is to block it wherever they can. I mean, what we've seen happen as a result of the sort of explosion in shale has happened in spite of the administration, not because of it. And the president has, in my view, is sort of shameless about this. When he's talking to environmental groups, or when his staff is talking to environmental groups, they will talk about how much they've done to block further exploration, to block further development. And then when he gives a speech to the public, he takes credit for this energy boom. Look, obviously, the economic implications are clear. It is, in effect, a tax cut. I'd like to see bigger tax cuts. But we'll take what we can get under the current regime. It also has pretty significant national security implications, though. The discussions that we could be having, we're not having them, again, because of decisions that the administration's making, but the pressure that we could be using on Russia, on Vladimir Putin and his expansionism, which is not going to end with Ukraine, the leverage that we could be using on Iran, which if sanctions are lifted and they go back to sort of pre-sanctions days, we'll be pumping out 800 billion barrels a day. I mean, that's just an insane amount. You could use that in your arguments if you were so inclined. The president's not inclined. I think after 2016, 2017, if there's a change in administration, I would argue even actually if there's, if Hillary Clinton is the next president, I think she would likely be more savvy about how to use that than this president has been.
Let's talk national security for a second. What's the truth about what's happening in the Middle East, and what's the answer for the United States, either in the short term and also in the long term?
Can we get some more drinks for everybody in the room?
Let's start shorten it. What's really happening over there right now?
It's a slow motion civil war. Across the region.
Okay.
You're seeing, I would argue that as a direct result of administration policy, you're seeing an emboldened Iran in terms of what it's doing regionally, not just in terms of the nuke deal. But I mean, remember there was the letter that the president sent Ayatollah Khamenei in October of 2014. The administration's position on the nuke negotiations with Iran has been from the beginning, at least its public position has been, we're going to decouple these negotiations with broader regime behavior. And they made that decision for, I think, an obvious reason. Broader regime behavior is very bad on a number of issues. It's human rights, it's a disaster. Continued ongoing, some would argue, escalating support for terrorist groups, Hezbollah, Hamas, including Al-Qaeda, which the administration itself has designated the Iranian regime for its support for Al-Qaeda, despite the fact that the Iranian regime is Shiite and Al-Qaeda is Sunni. So you have a regime that's a bad actor. It's a rogue regime by every assessment. It's a rogue regime. And the administration initially wanted to decouple nuclear negotiations with broader regime behavior for that reason, because they could say, we're not going to think about these things, we're going to make a deal on this. Of course, I think the argument from people who are skeptical of this deal from the beginning has been, regime behavior matters on these things. The nature of regime matters. I think it matters more than anything else. But obviously, that's not the way that the administration has chosen to handle it. What's been shocking, though, to me, is that the administration hasn't sort of just stuck to this line about decoupling nuclear negotiations from these other things, and pretended that Iran could be a benign actor in the region. In my view, the things that they've done in many cases have actually encouraged Iranian aggression, encouraged Iranian expansionism. In this letter that the president sent Ayatollah Khamenei in October of 2014, at least according to the Wall Street Journal, did exactly that, where you had the president say to the Ayatollah, look, we want to have this deal with you on nukes. And we're not going to target your client in Syria, Bashar Assad, despite the fact that his civil wars resulted in 200,000 deaths. We're not targeting him. We're not targeting his security forces. So sort of, don't worry about us. Don't worry about us thwarting your regional aggression. We're not going to do it. And then, I would argue, more remarkably, the president, who's so reluctant to talk about the war on terror, wrote in this letter to Ayatollah Khamenei and, in effect, said, we're on the same side in the war on terror. You're fighting ISIS, we're fighting ISIS, let's fight them together. And there's an Associated Press story that broke, I think, 2 or 3 hours before we all came over here. And there's this fight going on in Tikrit, Saddam Hussein's old town. It's a Sunni stronghold. Iraq is majority Shia, Iran is Shia. Tikrit is Sunni. It's where Saddam and the Ba'ath Party sort of reigned. And you're seeing these sectarian divisions sort of inflamed, I think, as a result of the way that the United States has approached the Iraqi government, has approached moderate Sunnis in Iraq and elsewhere. And the story that broke on the Associated Press had the United States, for the first time, the U.S.-led coalition, for the first time, flying surveillance missions in support of the attacks that are being led by Iran-backed militias against ISIS. And you can say, well, you know, it's against ISIS. We'd certainly like to see ISIS destroyed. But you don't want to be doing it if you're teaming up with Iran. It's the world's foremost state sponsor of terror and has been for two decades. The Iranian regime is responsible for a third of troop deaths, of American troop deaths, in Iraq and Afghanistan going back to the beginning of that conflict. The person leading the efforts in Tikrit and throughout the region is a guy named Qasem Soleimani. He's a bad man. He's the head of Iran's Quds Force. He's the guy who was responsible for arming, financing, funding, sending out these terrorists who were conducting, who were attacking U.S. troops in Iraq and Afghanistan using these EFPs. I think it's a disgrace that the administration is allowing this to happen and not saying a word about this. One final note on this question. You can tell I get fired up about this. So in 2011, 2012, the Obama administration, the Treasury Department of the Obama administration, as I mentioned, designated the Iran's Ministry of Intelligence, designated six senior al-Qaeda officials who were working in Iran, basically had free rein in Iran. Osama bin Laden's family fled to Iran after 2001, after the 9/11 attacks. Ayman al-Zawahiri's family fled to Iran after the 9/11 attacks. So the administration, at least the bureaucracy, down in the bowels of the bureaucracy, designates Iranian ministries and people, including Qasem Soleimani, and says these are bad, bad guys. We're going to do what we can to restrict their finances and whatnot. Because of this, what one senior Treasury official told me was a core pipeline of fighters that Iran was allowing operate on their soil that was moving into Afghanistan and Pakistan and was providing sort of the core sustenance of al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and Pakistan. So the Treasury Department designates these folks. They make the argument that this is critical to al-Qaeda and to its growth and to its continued operations. And I went back to the National Security Council and to a couple intelligence agencies last week, and I said, here are these designations from your own administration. This is not me at the Weekly Standard saying this. This isn't somebody on Fox News making this argument. This is what you said in 2011 and 2012. Is Iran still supporting al-Qaeda? Does this core pipeline still exist? And if so, what in the hell are you doing negotiating with Iran? And the answer I got back from the intelligence part of the operation was, absolutely. This relationship still exists. Iran is still playing this role. That's the end of our statement. And I went to the NSC, somebody who's NSC is part of the White House, and said, what's your answer to this? And why isn't this part of the negotiation? And I got very specific in my questions. I said, has anybody in the U.S. government raised this with anybody in the Iranian regime in the course of these nuclear negotiations? And then my second question was, has anybody in the U.S. government raised this with the Iranian regime, with anyone in the Iranian regime, ever, at any point in the Obama administration, 6 years of the administration, anybody ever talked about this with Iran? And the answer I got was, in effect, no. No, we're not doing that. There's a snarky comment from the spokeswoman from the NSC who said, as you know, we have decoupled these talks from the rest of Iran's regime behavior, and this is focused exclusively on nuclear issues. How you can have these negotiations ignoring the nature of the regime, what the regime has been since 1979, it would be like giving your retirement savings to a con artist, saying, hey, sign this piece of paper and we're good. I trust you at this point. It just doesn't work like that. We're going to pay for it. Can we get some more drinks? Sorry.
Yeah, no kidding.
Sorry.
Well, thank you again. From a Wisconsin guy to a Florida guy, maybe we'll have you back next year. We'll talk a little Jeb, Marco, Scott Walker, presidential politics. How about
that? That'd be great.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Hayes.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. That was great.
It's great. I'd like to ask our chairman to come up and make a brief announcement, and Rob Goodell is going to close up the evening.
Great job. I really, Steve, thank you so much. And most importantly, Jeff Atwater, thank you so much for being here. And most importantly, he stuck through the whole thing. And as a former politician, I always try to figure out ways. Nothing detrimental toward Commissioner Putnam, who was very kind to be here tonight. We appreciate it. Thank you both for your great remarks. Steve Hayes, man, you're the real deal. You are the real deal. It's great to see the guy that every day is on television, writing, and so on. Couple things. I'll be quick. I want to announce a new development at JMI. It's named in honor of a great man, one of my mentors, and a truly wonderful friend. JMI is proud to announce the launch of the J. Stanley Marshall Center for Educational Options. Okay, come on up. Come on up, Sue, Shirley, come on up. This new JMI Policy Center will build upon Dr. Marshall's legacy and pay tribute to his memory. As all of you here know, he formed JMI a long time ago. Actually, as many of you probably know, I was a student at FSU when he was president of FSU. It's a long time ago, long time ago. The center's efforts will place special emphasis on ideas like course choice and personal learning accounts so that all Florida students can obtain a customized education tailored to their unique needs, interests, abilities, and learning styles. We're pleased to have with us here tonight Stan's lovely wife, Shirley, and his daughter, Sue Marshall Jones.
All right.
I won't say much, but I just know that Stan would be very pleased with this center that they're starting. I think that's one of the best things they could do to add to his legacy with James Madison Institute. And thank you all for being here tonight.
Well, thank y'all. We really, Stan formed this group. Look at this crowd out there. None of them would be here if it weren't for Stan Marshall. It's really neat, really cool. Thank you so much. And before I turn it over to Rob Goodell, I want to thank everyone tonight for being here. A little history update on JMI. Look, I know I'm in between you and getting home. I get that. I understand that. Been there a few times. But I will tell you that the James Madison Institute is doing good financially. As I told you last year, we bought a new building. Our building, the columns, is paid for. We have money in the bank. I would say a lot of money, but if I said a lot of money, y'all would quit giving. So we have a little bit of money in the bank, and we need a lot more. I need a lot more money from you. So I'm the pitch man, and I get that, understand that. But we're doing good. We're spreading the word, spreading the gospel, as we would say in the panhandle. But thank you so much for being here tonight. It's so kind of you to it's a packed house. We sold out. And, Bob is sort of an easygoing guy. I break the arms from time to time. But tonight is a real testament about how good JMI is. So all my directors, all of our directors, thank you so much for being here. You know, you write the checks. A lot of you have written the checks out there. Keep on writing the checks. Keep on. I'm not a Southern Baptist preacher, but I could be one if I wanted to be one. Anyway, next I want to introduce to you Rob Goodell, one of our the members of our board of directors, who has a final introduction. Rob? He's a big-time guy.
You know, I've been involved in JMI for a number of years now, and I enjoy the fact that under Alan's leadership, and particularly that of Dr. Marshall, who is one of the finest people I've ever met, if you've noticed, and you've been coming with these functions for a number of years, for some reason, the venue keeps moving closer and closer and closer to Bobby Bowden Field. And for those of you who might enjoy that, you might know that I am president of the University of Florida Fighting Gator Boosters. Ladies and gentlemen, Viktor Frankl, the famed Austrian logotherapist and Holocaust survivor, said not too long ago that the last and ultimate freedom is the ability to choose one's response. Much of what we have witnessed over the last century has been defined by economics, and more importantly, how economically free markets have proven the best hope for human transformation and freedom. At JMI, our mission is to research, educate, and engage all citizens. You heard a lot about that tonight, and we're very proud of it. We are not a right-wing conservative think tank that some have suggested that we are. We don't use a litmus test. We don't hold grudges. We are beholden only to the principles that President Madison prescribed in his construction of the Constitution. In fact, the Economist newspaper categorizes those that believe in globalization and free trade as liberals, and those that don't believe in it to be conservatives. Labels don't always fit easily, and we don't use them at JMI. Rather, as businessmen and women, we must be pragmatists who understand that government must play an important and necessary role, but we believe that this is centered on a principle that government's responsibility is to build and maintain the infrastructure on which private enterprise can achieve, fail, and grow. Over the last 25 years, and particularly the last 10, we have seen aggressive encroachment of government, especially the federal government, into how private enterprise should run on top of that infrastructure. In areas of energy, communication, development, trade, finance, healthcare, and education. Every time that we as citizens consign some part of our capital, financial or human, to the federal government, we compromise our ability to choose our destiny. And we at JMI strongly disagree with that encroachment. We work hard to come up with the policies and alternative choices that we can make as citizens of the state of Florida to define our own destiny. We hope that you will help us in this effort by supporting us and engaging with us in order to find the best policies and practices that can be implemented, because at the end of the day, those are the only ones that matter. I would like to close with a quote from Margaret Mead, the American cultural anthropologist, who said, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, concerned citizens can change the world." Indeed, ladies and gentlemen, nothing else ever has. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being our friends and choosing wisely. And may God protect the great state of Florida. Have a wonderful evening.